Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. In this video, we will be making this Lily of the Valley panel. If you also want to make this, I will have the pattern available for sale on my Etsy page. I will link it in the description box. I think for the colors, I'm going to keep it pretty predictable with a blue sky, white flowers, green leaves, and then I have this cool clear iridescent border to put on. So let's get tracing. So I was aiming to line up with that line, but the camera was in my way. That's the hazards of filming. Sometimes the camera gets in my way. Sometimes when I'm breaking the glass, I'm very cautious and I use a lot of tools to make sure it breaks okay. This doesn't want to go very nicely. I didn't put enough pressure on that original score. Some glass requires more pressure than others. This one doesn't even make that nice scoring sound. So you can't go by ear. You just have to go by feel. Okay, so for the background, I suggest using a nice cathedral that, you know, isn't too difficult to break, because some of these pieces have some deep curves. Now, if you have a saw, then, I mean, by all means, use whatever glass you'd like. Normally I don't stop mid-score like that, but I had to get up on my tippy toes to look over the camera. Filming a tutorial can sometimes be tricky because the camera just gets in my way sometimes. It makes things difficult. So technically, when you are cutting, you want to stop your score before going off the edge, because you can chip your glass and everything. But sometimes, especially when you're doing little scores, it just slips off the edge, and if you don't chip anything, it's not a big deal. All the scraps that I cut, I put into this little bin separating my color. I'm trying this thing where I clean up my scraps as I go, so I don't wind up with piles and piles of glass on here. Let's see. Oh, I did it. I usually can't break glass with my fingers. It's difficult. Now, double grousing pliers like this come in so handy when you have thin edges that you're cutting, because if I just took my running pliers and went boop, there's a chance that that score could cut off the tip, and we don't want that. See? All nice. Also, if you see my hand shaking, it's not because I'm scoring really hard, it's just because filming makes me a little nervous. I don't know why I'm in this room all by myself. Okay, so some of these cuts are gonna be a little tricky. You might not be able to get into these as much as you want, and you'll just have to use your 1-inch or 3/4-inch grinder bit and grind it out. It's not that big of a deal. And then especially these little ones, if you have a saw, you can just go zoo, zoo, zoo. Otherwise, you're just going to take your 1/4-inch bit and grind it out. Okay, now this one is number 8, is really thin up here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to score along the line of number 8, but then I'm going to curve slightly before and finish the line on 10. So I leave a bigger space of glass there. Okay, that worked how I wanted it to. And then I'm not going to try to get too close. I'm just gonna start where the paint marker ends. Okay, and then the rest of that curve we'll just grind. I could have gotten closer in here with my score, but once again, I'm gonna change this camera angle right now. Okay, this might be better. It's not in my way. So some of these sometimes glass explodes, that's nice. Okay, so that's about as well as I can get the curvy scallop. Like I said, the 1/4-inch bit will take care of the rest. And sometimes with these little curves, you just need to take bits and pieces out at a time. Okay, so I think that covers the most difficult cuts, so I'll just finish up the rest. Also, if you don't have a pair of narrow grousing pliers, I highly suggest you get a pair, because it really helps if you're scoring out really small pieces. it helps you break those out, because a normal pair of grossing pliers, you could use the corner, but you don't get the same, these just work so nice. So yeah, that's as close as I could get on this one. We will just grind the rest. Okay. All right, now that all of the rough cuts are done, we need to grind it all to fit. Because I mostly use, I'm usually working with little pieces like this, I almost exclusively use a 3/4 inch bit with the standard grit. I use the 1 inch bit sometimes, but it's annoying to switch between the two, so I'm usually just using the 3/4 bit. Now, I'm not gonna lie, all these pieces with the wavy lines are going to be kind of annoying, but they are doable. And like I said before, if you have a saw, you could have just cut out that wavy line or those little divots and then called it a day. But most people don't have a saw, so that is why I am doing it the old-fashioned way. I cut as close as I could inside the little teeny tiny curves, and then I'm just gonna grind the rest. So let's start with these annoying pieces. All right, and when I'm grinding, I like to wear these little cut-resistant finger cots on just my thumbs and my pointer fingers. Someone asked me once why I don't just wear full gloves. I mean, the gloves that are gonna give you the protection you need are really thick and bulky, and I feel like I lose dexterity, so I just want my fingertips covered. That's the closest I can grind with this bit. Let's move on to the 1/4 inch bit. Now, I've used this bit a lot, so the bottom is probably worn out. I might have to hold it up, and then I just kind of fling water onto it. Perfect, just what we wanted. Here's a little tip. I'm sure I've mentioned this before, but when you are grinding cathedral glass that's smooth, I highly suggest putting down some foam, or I think foam works the best, because when you are grinding on the grinding surface, especially this metal part, there can be little bits of glass that get trapped under, and the vibration causes little scratches on the glass. And especially if you have the smooth cathedral glass, when you hold up to the light, you're going to notice those little scratches. Now, obviously, you're not going to notice them from far away, but if you're up close, they are noticeable sometimes, and it's annoying. So for the border, I used this. I want to say this is called reed glass. Let's see if I can focus. You can see that it's got deep grooves. So if I were to foil this as is, it would be really, I'd probably rip it a whole bunch. So I'm gonna have to use, well, I can either use the ripple bit to smooth out those edges so it's nice and flat when foiling, or if you don't have a ripple bit, you can literally just hold your glass at like a slight angle and whittle those down. Alright, first thing I'm going to do is take some alcohol and wipe off all of the pieces. Make sure my paint marker's off, there's no dust or oil. There shouldn't be any oil. I mean, after grinding and rinsing in water, it's fine. Before I foil, I'm actually going to set up my pattern on just this cheap ceiling tile. I use the Morton layout system because I want, if you're gonna make a rectangular or square panel, you want to make sure that it is square or rectangle. You don't have to put pins in every hole, but I don't know, I'm crazy. I don't know why I was grabbing all these little ones. I might as well do at least one side full length. Can use this as a guide, and I will start foiling the perimeter, and then if I need to grind any adjustments, it'll be piece of cake. Okay, now we're going to foil one of these curvy pieces, because you're probably wondering, how am I going to foil that without ripping all of the foil? And I will show you. Now, I'm using silver-backed foil here because whenever I foil something that's white glass, I use silver because it keeps the glass bright. Like, if you use copper-backed foil, even though this is opaque, if you use copper-backed foil or black-backed foil, the copper will give the white glass a coppery glow, and the black glass will give, or the black backed foil will give the white glass a dark glow. The silver just keeps the piece nice and light. I mean, it's something that's not super noticeable, but it's definitely, I've foiled white glass in with copper backed foil before, or well, just copper foil. And it, when the piece was done, I could tell that it had an orangish coppery glow to it. It was weird. It's one of those things that, I mean, you may or may not notice, but I noticed and it bothered me. Okay, so we've got it wrapped in foil. We're gonna burnish. Now, because I'm using 7/32, that also helps keep tearing to a minimum because it's less copper that needs to stretch. So then we're just going to bend it over and then go nice and slow. And I mean, if the copper does rip, that's not a big deal. We can touch it up. And there we go. So now I'm all ready to solder, but first I'm going to get my zinc came cut and ready. I'm using 1/8 inch capping came. You can use 1/4 inch if you want. This is such a small panel, I just want the nice thin border of 1/8 inch. So I have my tabletop cutoff saw set up to a 45 degree angle. You can also just use normal wire cutters too. Gives you a nice 45. Now we are finally ready to solder. I put some painter's tape in a couple spots just because I want to make sure to keep the sky area and the border nice and square. So I'm going to go through and tack solder a few pieces together. Alright, soldering is done. We're gonna take some flux remover. I have so many different cleaning products. I usually use CJ's flux remover. Today I'm gonna use NutriClean and hot water. I usually clean my pieces like 2 or 3 times. So I'm gonna scrub this for a good while. Today we'll try a little bit of baking soda. I guess you can never be too clean, right? Nice and clean. We will let that dry and then I'll steel wool and apply patina. Okay, so this has air dried for a little bit. Now I'm going to just lightly steel wool it, nothing too hard. I just want to shine those lines up so it takes the patina well. Make sure you wear a mask, gloves, and then I vacuum it up afterwards. When I steel wool, I like to go just light and fast. So now it's nice and shiny and ready to go. So I'm going to take super blue, or gun blue, whatever you want to call it, and do the zinc came first. Now I'm just going to take my Novacan Black Patina and do the rest. Last thing I need to do, apply some wax, let it dry overnight, and buff it off. I'm going to use my favorite Clarity finishing compound.